This is an interactive session. This is an hour of just case discussion. We're all experts, that's why we're here. And we all want to do is learn from each other. And we've got four cases to present, which I can go through you now. One is a high energy young distal femur, and the other three are more the osteoporotic femurs we see, which kind of balances your normal workload. So our first case is pretty high energy. A 34-year-old male, motorcycle. Forget about the tibia, that's a different day, that's a different meeting. 34-year-old male, motorbike injury, associated chest and wrist injuries, with a significant open injury, and the approach is not going to be a part of discussion on this bit, because it's going to be open. Many diseases, PCs and QE and artificial pieces. Comes in, 6 o'clock at night. I'm going to jump because we've got limited time because I think we don't need to talk about some of the resuscitation stuff with this. We want to talk about fixation methods. We've got a CT on admission, the distal pulses and circulation sensation were intact. No evidence of compartment syndrome. It was hugely open. Anyway, the CT, and I'll give you all the facts in the world, but it's just smashed. Yeah, they don't really help you. There's no proximal extension. The tendon is intact, but the damage, the tendon is fractured, but not in the body, just a bit off the side. So, let's go back. This is the fracture. Initially washed out and debrided on the night of injury. A bridging exosomal fixation was applied across the knee. Still had pulses, still had sensation. So the question is, how are we going to treat this? And what we do out of those loose fragments, which we, in an aggressive plastic surgeon, if you kind of don't stop them, we'll throw it in the bin thinking it's all dead. Don't know. Just fix it. So just fix it. So how are we going to fix it?
With great skill.
With great skill, well. So fix it well. So what are the strategies? What are the issues?
I presume the wound is anteriorly.
Yeah, the wound is anteriorly. You can get medially and laterally through it. And I will show you a picture of the wound. Don't worry about the approach. The whole thing is basically approachable. Not posteriorly, but you can get around posteriorly. Reconstruct the articular surface. So what are you going to use? I think all the information is there. I don't think the CT scan really adds anything to it. Sorry? Is anyone going to nail this? No one's going to nail this. Is anyone going to frame this? Everyone's going to fix it. So what can you use to regain your alignment?
You need a joint before you can get the alignment.
Okay, so you need to try and fix the joint first. Okay. So the medial femoral condyle is basically intact. There was a fracture through it from this place. So we're going to use that to build up, I think.
So one of the issues that you're going to face when you're putting this bit back together. So if you're going to start with the articular surface, what's the issue you're going to face with the articular surface?
You have bone loss.
You may have bone loss in the middle. All right. So you may have loose bits sitting in there with bits of road in it. What are you going to do with those?
You make it look like Sputnik. Hundreds of little K-wires hold everything vaguely in the place and get your principal condylar alignment and condylar fragments right. Because what's going to make a difference is not the beautiful...
So you're going to try and turn a C-type to a B-type. You're going to try and put your condyles back on the shelf.
No, to each other. To reconstruct...
You look at the middle of that.
So you need to reconstruct the shape, the morphology of the articular block. You're not going to reconstruct the joint surface perfectly, but you need the morphology right, because the alignment from the reconstruction of the articular block is going to be an issue.
So what are you going to do with the loose bits of articular surface, and there may be one or two bits, and actually got quite some large chunks of articular cartilage on them, that may have bits of road on them as well. What are you going to do with those?
Clean them, put them back.
So how many would throw them away? How many would debride them and throw them away?
Depends how big they are.
If
they're big enough to be useful.
Depends how contaminated. So this was contaminated. This was a big, it gone into a ditch. It was mud, grass, and they had done proper debriding from the night before, and the plastic surgeons had made a huge, I mean, it was the biggest ALT flap they were going to put on. There was a big hole here, and they washed it all. They did, the lavage, they did pulse lavage to make it look shiny. And I tell you, on the night of injury, the guy essentially put all the big bits back into the wound and covered it with a vac. So all the bits are available, to you. The little crumbs came out.
I think Alex's point is right. If you've got big bits, even if they've been contaminated, they need to stay. The little bits, those gaps, if they're contaminated, they go. So you've got to keep the whole shape.
What if those little bits don't have a lot of articular surface on them, but do add to the stability of the articular component?
Make the shape so it isn't stable. Yeah. Change the shape. You've got to maintain the articular part. So I accept that.
So you're going to throw away a bit of bone that, once you put your screws on to hold that articular bit together, potentially is going to mean that your articular bit is going to change shape.
No, you must maintain the shape. So if you have a gap, you need to be able to support
it. You've got to have a planar surface, which is the condyles, which doesn't have to be what it used to be, but it has to be a flat surface which will sit on a plateau. And you need the width. Yeah. The front to back doesn't matter, and to be fair, the height up and down will become irrelevant very soon. So you need to keep enough bits of bone to keep a flat condyle spot on a plateau.
So that the width is absolutely crucial.
Yeah. The morphology.
If you squeeze it too much, it's never going to work.
It won't do. So you almost certainly going to end up putting some sort of fully threaded, large fragment screw across those condyles and look into a gap.
Good. So does everyone understand that concept? You're trying to get absolute stability, but that does not necessarily mean you're lagging, that you're trying to squeeze it together. You're trying to have stability. And the other concept is maintaining as much of the articular surface as you can. And there is evidence that you can keep those bits of bone with or without articular surface on them if you have stability. Right? They will heal.
Just moving on, so we're going to keep our articular chunks on with. Did the crumbs go, big articular bone. What about the non-articular bits of bone? Because traditionally we're told to throw it all away, no attachments, yet, pull test, whatever, it goes in the bin.
Pull test only matters for diaphyseal bone.
So who's going to keep those?
No
soft tissue attachments. You can take them off, put them on the back table.
Are you talking about the metadiaphyseal?
Yes.
You helped use a reduction. So about 30% said they were keeping. There's been if I asked that same question 5 years ago, I bet you only 5% of people were keeping. So in our hospital, we've been keeping those in tibia and femur now for the last 4 or 5 years.
Can I just stop you there? All those people who are going to keep those bits of bone, can you just put your hands up? Put your hands, keep your hands up if you're in a trauma unit, not a major trauma centre. That's interesting. Okay.
So we've been keeping those, we've been washing them, putting them back. Because you put back the articular cartilage, and we say, a staphylococcus can't tell the difference between an articular bit of bone and a normal bit of bone. So you're going to put one back, you'd save risk of infection here. But we do wash them thoroughly. We get the pulse of iron off the drill says, and give them a little wash.
The only counter to that argument is that you can't recreate or replace articular bone, so frontal bone with cartilage on it, whereas you've got a gap in a non-articular bit of bone, there is potential to replace that.
It is, but we use them as structural graft, basically, and to help the reduction. Especially in tibias, when you've got a big chunk. There's nothing worse than having kind of a nail and there's a big chunk of bone missing. You think you may as well put a frame on the transport, but you put this bit of bone on, we put a separate plate on, and you'll be amazed how many times you get away with it.
Alex. So, I mean, for me in this, the question of putting the bits back in this is going to be about how you're going to relate the condylar block to the shaft in a few minutes' time. So if you're going to retain length, you don't want to have a defect, you need to put those bits back.
So that's what Richard was saying.
That very first question, what do you envisage your problems here? One of the big problems here is judging reduction.
Yeah.
How are you going to get your length alignment rotation right if you've just thrown enormous chunks in the bin?
And again, reduction in the width of the condyles. If you make it too small, it's not going to fit any particular plateau.
So what about the vascularity of the fragment?
There is no
vascularity. So before we had a concept that no vascularity, so we don't used to put it back in place.
Can we come on to that?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to move forward just a second. So we were going to plate it. Okay. We did use the medial femoral condyle to judge our length because that was we could actually lock it in. You've got to be very careful about valgus and varus deformity when you've got a big hole on the lateral side. So quite a lot of screening, looking at the other knee, which is flat on the radial loosened table, always helps. There's four questions there. whatever you do, we've lost some bone. We're going to have a big defect in the metaphysis there. The medial column is intact. Is anyone going to fill that hole, which will be a hole, with bone graft, bone substitute, or cement? Anyone at all? You'll put cement in.
Like a masculate type.
Masculate type cement. Anyone else fill metaphyseal bone holes with anything else? That, I can't believe that.
If you've got something like CERAMEN G or something, which has got antibiotics and
so what's
CERAMEN?
It's 1,200 quid a packet.
Is it antibiotic cement?
Yeah.
What about
it's calcium something.
So it's a very substitute.
And how is it?
The other option is piece of a muscle flap.
Piece of a muscle flap. They're digging AOT flaps, so you're going to take down a bit of quads to put in the middle.
Well, probably those quads, but you ask a plastic surgeon or you can fill that with some muscle.
What's the evidence behind that?
Not much evidence.
And what's the point of it?
Yeah.
Because it's sort of easy to calm the stem cells down. In fact, it lasts a long bit for the union.
Not primarily, I'm sure.
No, not primarily.
Anyone else doing muscle flap? So any couple of people are going to fill it with some pixie dust. In the States, they all fill it with some expensive pixie dust. They all fill all the holes in there. So money's not an issue. Okay. Type of plate. Everyone use an anatomical plate. I think that's standard. Probably one locking options distally would everyone agree? So locking distal femoral plate. I'm going to go to the fourth question. Does the metal make a difference? Hands up. Who thinks the metal, either titanium or stainless steel, makes a difference?
Difference to what?
To what?
Anything. To
outcome.
It makes a difference. Which makes a difference?
All right, well, the stainless steel is much more shapeless. I think I'm more happy with
the old ones, do you think that's an issue with the new ones?
Apparently not, I haven't had one that has yet.
Okay. Anyone else? Do you think it makes any difference at all, apart from colour?
So if you, in your hospital, had the choice of titanium versus stainless steel, and you had both on the shelf, money wasn't an issue, Would you be bothered about which one you chose?
No.
Okay, good. Okay.
So we can move on then. Yeah. I thought that was a very big issue, because actually some people say one's better than the other. There is actually, the only clinical evidence is actually on historic implants or the old implants, which shows the list was better than the same still. But actually it's what you do with the plate is so much more valuable.
Is it still the case that we should mix implants? No. They have to be really close together to
get the autolysis. That's been approved. And you can mix what you want.
And you can put the stainless steel screws in a titanium implant and vice versa.
Yes, that makes no difference.
Thank you. I think
sorry, can I have a question that you've not put on? Because it's interesting, you put plate in the singular.
Yeah, we'll come on to that.
Quiet now.
What about locking the shark? So I'm going to go back to one thing. This is going to take a long time to heal. There's no question. This is at least 6 months, however you treat it, to heal. There's no OPG or whatever is going to make any difference to that. So this is a young bone, 34-year-old. Who's going to lock the shaft? Four, five, six? Okay.
So tell us, why are you going to lock the shaft?
Well, although the risk of pullout is going to be obviously much higher distally, my gut feeling would be that you would still potentially have a risk of proximal pullout, and the pullout strength with locking screws is in theory better than those of conventional screws.
What does locking a shaft do then?
Rigid.
So would I be intending to use quite a long plate?
Okay.
So I think that that potential risk of stiffness would potentially be offset. I mean, if you put your locking screws just above the fracture site, I think it would be a...
So you have a long working length of the plate, but you still lock the top?
Yeah.
Do you think locking the top of a young bone makes any difference at all?
Marginally. Probably.
Does it give you any advantage or disadvantage? The guys who put their hands up and lock it, what advantage does it give you?
So it's easy, you're not constrained by the shape of the plate. Okay. So you can have, when you do your alignment, if you don't use a lock screw, your alignment will be determined by where you place the plate.
So distal femoral plates are different from proximal tibial plates.
It's the exact opposite.
Yeah. Distal
it's
femoral
exact, plates. It's the exact opposite. Yeah, exactly. If you use a locking screw proximally, the shape of the femur that you end up with is completely determined by where you put the plate. Right? If you use a non-locking screw proximally, you can make it any shape you like.
So I would argue with distal femoral plates, it doesn't matter what company they are, they fit. And if it doesn't fit, it's usually because you haven't reduced it. Proximal tibial plates, so much anatomic variation is not the same thing. Even anterolateral proximal tibial and distal tibial plates. But femur plates, 99 times out of 100, when it doesn't fit, you go back and look at it, you haven't reduced it. There's a rotational element. Does everyone agree with that?
Yeah.
I'm not making that up. Yeah. So I disagree that, you know, if it doesn't fit properly, you need to put a locking screw. I think you need to reduce it.
Actually, there isn't this plate with the older patients, whether they just have a bit of a lateral bow, it often sits about just at the top.
The old historic plates, but I think modern day plates are made on, you know, CT cadaver kind of models and things like that. They know the normal anatomical variations, and these are generally fit extremely well. There will be exceptions. Yeah, we've got an osteogenesis imperfecta where they have bent in 90 degrees because of previous fractures. But there will be exceptions. Generally, a normal 34-year-old, it should fit.
Andy.
Well, just the point, there is a good thing for an injury looking at locking. So they looked at a set gap, sort of locking, non-locking, or locking. I mean, the big difference is your screw closest to the fracture site proximally. If that's locking, it'll make things a lot stiffer. So that, I think the most proximal one is irrelevant, but it's the one closest to the fracture site on the shaft.
Working length of your plate, if it's a lock screw, your first thing, it makes it much stiffer than if it's more.
Yes, the first screw that you come to is your head up the shaft. If that's a locking screw, and it will dramatically increase the stiffness and also pull out the top of it. So it's just whether that's a good idea, you might want some movement here.
Matt, you're going to say something?
I'm just intrigued by this idea that everyone's got the same radius of cleavage in their femurs. There's no variation at all between patients of different ages in the radius of curvature of the femur, or are
there is a variation, but the plates will accommodate that because you can put.
In a 2 foot tall female.
You're pushing the 90% rule, aren't you?
Well, I don't know, unless we've got anatomic plates that are variable by a patient age and radius of curvature, then why not lock it in there?
But that just goes counter to your argument. So if you lock it, if you've got. If someone's a dwarf throw and you're putting it in a dwarf with that, and you put it locked proximally, you are making that femur match the shape of the plate. Yes, you are. You are. You have to. The plate sits on the femur, and you put that plate onto the femur, and the femur will match the shape of the plate. Because you're going to reduce the plate onto the femur.
That's only if the plate is on the femur.
What if you use the plate properly?
In this sort of fracture, how many people are going to not use the plate as your template?
Only
distal. So you've made sit it wherever you like.
You should fix thrush distal, not proximal.
Okay, so the locking, we're going to move on a little bit. The locking option, we noticed about 20% of people are going to lock the shaft. Okay, so what else do we need to do with this fracture? So I'm going to move forward. So this was the wound. So you can see the plastic surgeons are raising their ALT flat when we're doing this. Forget about the tibia. So this is the big hole here in the lateral femoral condyle, just like the lateral femoral condyle. You can get over the other side. So it is a big hole. So the answer is the medial side. Who routinely plates the medial side? Routinely
for what?
Okay, would you put a fixed angle plate on the other side or just put a standard?
No, I just use a 3.5 LCP plate, so that's just begging just to be reduced and fixed as an anting line plate on the medial side.
Exactly what we did, and we put that on to aid our reduction, and we left it on because we felt it gave us some stability. You notice some of the screws didn't actually go to the other side because there's no bones. We couldn't get that screw going anywhere.
Whether or not you put that medial plate is critical to the answer to the previous question.
About locking the
shaft. As to whether you lock or not lock, and where you put the most distal screw in the shaft.
Okay.
because that alters the mechanics completely.
You're right, because you're making something a box.
Yes.
Not yeah, no, I agree with that. But these single plates are more buttress plates. They don't give huge stability. You wouldn't just fix it with just a buttress plate, but actually they make a big difference to the outcome. Okay, so
a big positive difference.
Sorry?
A big positive difference.
Yeah, I agree. So we're left with that, okay? Forget about the tibia. Tibia is a different way. I'm just going to move it on because we've got a bit of time. We put on one separate little third tuber. That was to hold a big bony fragment which kept on wanting to move. And we're literally putting that as a spacer, as a bit like a live bone graft. And we fix the tibia and everything else. So the truth is, this patient was in bed for 2 weeks because they're worried about the flap, so he didn't move it. And he was they didn't mobilize him for 2 weeks. So we were 2 weeks down the line. The wounds are healed at this stage. How would you mobilise? Forget about the rest of them. How would you mobilise this femur? Would you allow them to flex it if the plastic surgeons allow you to do it? Anyone? Full flexion?
Yeah.
No, I think that's crucial, isn't it? Yeah, there's nothing worse than this. The tendon ligaments were intact. The ACL was intact. PCL had gone. But, you know, we thought stiffness is going to be a much bigger problem than instability.
Tim, do you do anything to prevent fixed flexion deformity that's common?
Did we do anything? We splinted him out at night time in a brace.
So night splint.
Yeah, night splint. Yeah, we splinted him out straight in a brace. good question. How long the place should be? So we want to go past the diaphysis. If it's an osteoporotic fracture, I try and go as high as possible. I tend to put a 12-hole plate on these. I just write it down. I don't know. I haven't got a rule.
What do you mean? Many of these things that you're talking about has to do with the amount of wobbliness you want to have a fracture. So the length of the plate,
so we can't measure strain, can we?
No, we can't measure that. So, but by saying you've definitely got to use a forcible screw, or you definitely can't use a locking, you definitely need a buttress plate, I'm going to fix that little bit of bone. You're changing the strain at the fracture site very considerably in each one of the interventions, and yet none of us can measure intraoperatively what the strain is.
No.
Nor do we know how the strain should change necessarily with the healing of the fracture. So I'm not sure that it's easy to say cases a buttress plate is a good idea, or in all cases a non-locking screw.
This is all anecdotal, isn't it? There's no evidence.
We do know what happens to the strain at the fracture as it heals.
Yeah, but you can't change it easily with your implants.
Not immediately. So if you go back 20... it's almost exactly 30 years. John Kenwright's paper was 98, wasn't it, Chris? So John Kenwright did a really seminal bit of in vivo animal research and showed that as a fracture heals, particularly a type C type fracture, it essentially zips up. If you think about all the non-unions you've ever seen, you never ever see a type C non-union. They all become type A fractures, and they've usually got an oblique fracture line. So the strain that the fracture is healing actually increases, and the rigidity of your fixation actually needs to increase the further you go down the healing line.
Yeah, I agree. If it doesn't, you can augment it as you go along, but they generally...
And we need to recognise that. You know, when you look at this, it's probably worth saying to the patient from the day one, this may well go to a non-union, and you may well need another operation for me to do something to get this to heal, but I hope it's going to be a relatively straightforward operation where I'm actually going to increase the rigidity.
I agree, but what I meant was it's very difficult at the first operation to judge the amount of wobbliness you want residually left over.
I agree. We don't know what it is.
So I completely agree with what you say, that surgeons, we need to have rules of thumb, don't we?
Yeah.
Because you're there, you've got to do something. We're all there, we've all been there, you don't know what to do. So my rule of thumb is that if I can model the fracture and see it reasonably wobbling it, I've not got enough stability.
Yeah.
You know, if I can actually deform the fracture in my hands, then that's not stable enough for me to finish. I agree with the argument about the medial plate. You could take it off, but it's a fantastic reduction aid. So you needed it there for the reduction. You could argue you could take it off afterwards. I wouldn't, but it's a good argument. And then my rule of thumb is common for multi-fragmentary fractures is if I'm using a bridge plate, I'm looking for callus, if I go to four to five times the length of the multi-fragmentary segment. That is a rule of thumb. It has utterly no science, but at some point you're in the surgeon, you've got to make up your mind.
Just on that point, sorry, just a question. I mean, is there any reason why you'd use a shorter plate? So you use the 12, which is a long one,
yeah.
And what system you're using.
Yeah.
Chris has got saying go longer. Why not just use, always use a long plate?
I always do.
Is there anyone that's got another bit?
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily use a long plate if I'm going for absolute fabulous. The very thing is necessary. So if you use a simple A-type fracture, you're trying to fix the lag screw, then I think you only need four screws above the fracture. And,
you only need them, but is there a disadvantage?
No, there's no disadvantage, just a slightly bigger surgical pin, but I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
I think in your osteoporotic bone, you should cross your spine every time.
So what we're saying is a principle, if you know, that, as you say, we'll work by those, and I'm Bob would hate this, but and that a use long plates as a principle.
Does anyone use short plates?
In this picture you can see, if you go, as you go longer, if you're splitting off the femur, it's on the lateral view.
I mean, it's falling off the back.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the bow.
And this is the problem, the bow never quite fits. The longer you go, the bigger the problem.
Well, the joy is not using non-lock screws, you can angle your screws appropriately.
So just aim up the corner of the board.
Last question, sorry. If it wasn't an open fracture, what approach was used?
I was using midline at this point. Yeah, you need to get both corners. You can sometimes get over from the lateral side to the medial side on some of the simple things. Or this. Yeah, this one.
I think in order to
split,
you have to look like a little
To midline, which side of the patella?
I use lateral side of the patella. Yeah.
You can do two approaches.
Yeah, there's no right or wrong. It's you know, make life easier. I think trying to do that at the lateral position Okay. So this patient is about 2 months down the line. You can see that this screw was actually in nothing. But it's under a flap, so that's okay. So he was fully weight-bearing in 6 weeks. Well, he says he's fully weight. He wasn't really. He was still painful, mainly from the tibia. Actually, that's a different story. Now, he's flexing from about 5 to 110 degrees, which is pretty good, I think, because he's got a big flap on there. It's not perfect, but I don't think we're going to have a huge amount of better. But that's functional. He's still got a big hole. Who's going to graft? No infection. Anyone graft? And you wait. How long do you wait?
At least 3 months.
3 months? Anyone? 6 months? 6 months?
If it's not filled up in 3 months, it's not going to fill.
If it's not filled up in 3 months, it's not going to fill, you say?
Metalware starts breaking, then I'll worry.
So you would act if there's metalware failure?
Within 6 months.
Yeah, within 6 months. Yeah. I don't think anyone will disagree with that. Anyone either proactively intervene in the first 6 months if there's no metalware problems?
I think if his medial column unites, you may see an extremely long time for that hole under the lateral plate to then fill in, because he'll now have an intact medial column and you've got a big plate on the lateral side, and it may be a year and a half for
that
to fill
in.
So no, I think if the medial column unites, then the gap is not a problem at all.
Okay. The general observation is that you've got a long plate, the radiological healing times are often extended, even in the absence, so the patient will be clinically well, but the x-ray shows delayed healing.
But this isn't locking, is it?
No, but
this is it's a break. It's not a fixable locking. So what will you do, Nigel?
I'd wait.
You wait?
A long time.
No way. If every time I see him it looks a bit better and the network hasn't failed and he's comfortable, then he gets a pain, I think that's a different matter you have to act.
Don't go looking for trouble, wait if it comes to find you.
Well, wait for pain, wait for failure. Chris, will you do anything different?
I tend to make my decision very early, which is if I think it's a massive defect that's going to need grafting, I tend to put cement in and plan to come back in 6 to 8 weeks and do a masquerade type technique. If it's a judgment call at the time, if I think there's enough bone that's going to heal in this situation, clearly I would hang it in there. The key thing is to keep looking for early failure around the screws, because that's where it always shows, unless the plate breaks, which is rare.
He's due to come to clinic next week, so I don't know what the story is. I'm going to move on.
You've got a range of opinions to offer.
Okay, this is an interval game, is it? Nigel, do you want to?
That's right, you're okay, go on.
82-year-old patient, there's no hip above it, and she has low energy fall, but there's no other particular issues about it. And she's got a pericostatic fracture, which is a low pericostatic fracture. which you can just see go through there and going across there.
And we'll take it that the implant is well cemented, yeah. It's not loose.
It was working well beforehand.
I think you need to be involved with traffics.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo. Tell us about traffics.
Traffics is a study randomising. Yeah, randomising nails versus lateral plates for distal femoral
fractures, such as this.
Such as this.
Okay. Is that too low to now?
Just be aware, in traffics that it has to be an implant you can get a nail through.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
can through that.
There is a list available of those that can be penetrated.
So who's going to nail, who's going to play? It should be 50-50 if we knackle boy, shouldn't it?
Yeah.
We're going to randomise.
The computer.
Who would be happy to randomise this patient between a nail and a plate?
Well, I'll see.
There you go, you're all enrolled in traffic, so that's fantastic.
Okay,
that's good. Okay. Okay. Just say we chose a plate, it was randomised to a plate. That was a picture in the last year, actually. It looks pretty good, doesn't it? Anyone treat that conservatively? So, anyone replace that if there's a well-fixed implant when they put a distal femoral replacement? Okay. So we're all going to plate it. What position are you going to put the patient?
Supine.
Hands up, supine. Hands up, lateral.
So take me through this, Tim, because this is a great learning.
So this is a flexion deformity fracture, isn't it? Okay. And you need to correct that flexion. Now, when you're doing a supine, you need to bend the knee to help reduce it. Someone taught me a trick, just do these lateral, and it's so much easier. Because you're basically looking down on it, and you can correct the flexion really easily on the lateral when you lose the table. Forget about that. So if you look at this, it's so easy to make a fairly limited incision over the distal femur. You can flex up and you can get that flexion deformity back. You're not worried about the AP alignment so much, because it's going to reduce itself, isn't it, if you can see it. And so I actually do most of these distal femurs, which are not hugely comminuted. I don't have to go in for medial fixation laterally. So most of the periprosthetics I do laterally. And it's you're working downhill rather than working uphill, the tissues will fall away from you. And I find it's much easier to image because you're looking straight down or just a true lateral. I just find it's a much easier position to do. I have no evidence for it.
Tim, have you tried nailing the same?
Sorry? I haven't tried nailing, but I would like to.
Well, it should work.
Yeah, it should work, because it's just easier. So I do these, and you know, it is, the incisions are easy, the approach is easy, you can extend the incisions if you want to, because, you know, this is a simple fracture pattern.
So for the AP, you just turn the leg to the machine?
Yeah, you go underneath, it's not ready to just go underneath. And you get these kind of views, you know, you can show that you've reduced it on the flexion deformity, because that's what you need to do. The message here is, I think these are much easier in a lateral position. So next periprosthetic fracture, try the lateral position on a radial distal table, and you will be surprised that it's an easier approach.
And what's your rationale with screw happening there? So I tend to pick these two incisions, I would supply the radial distal triangle, you could have a wee set up in the knee, and that gets rid of the flexion deformity, absolutely to your placing an anatomical femur. Fix it distally, and then make a decent size incision, so you could free bicocular screws proximally, you get the absolutely spot on. You screws there, you're going for relative stability, yet you fire the screws percutaneously all the way up.
Yeah, non-locking. No non-locking screws.
Yeah. Why? What, in terms of working on it, stuff?
This screw was across the fracture here.
I'd argue that's not a relatively stable construct. I think that's an absolutely stable construct.
Yeah, so I lack the fracture through that one there.
This is an interesting argument, because how many people here would do that, and how many would bridge it? So how many people would bridge it? This is an interesting argument, because I was asked to chair a debate on this in Switzerland about 5 years ago, looking at these fractures. And once you go across the English Channel, everyone bridges these. They all go for relatively stable construct. And it just doesn't make sense to me at all. I would go for an absolutely stable construct in this. It's in a type A fracture, it wants stability.
It's a case of Nigel.
The
incision distally, Tim hasn't made a massive incision, and mine wouldn't be any bigger than that. It's very low.
But how much exposed the fracture has to get the screw across it to lag it?
You can get through that incision. It's a very low fracture.
Yeah, you exposed the fracture.
It was a laggable fracture.
Yeah. You can see the lag screw. I think we just put it in as a, by the time we compressed it, it kind of closed off.
Have you routinely CT this before?
I didn't CT this because I didn't think it added anything.
Yeah, well, sometimes you make your start incision and it's mush.
We still use non-locking screws from the shaft.
Is there a problem with lagging and then locking the bottom screw?
So if you're lagging and then locking top and bottom, no, because it's type A and you're going for absolute stability. No, there isn't. But Tim and I are pretty much of the same opinion. I never say never, but I almost never put locking screws in the diaphysis. And it doesn't matter whether that patient is 20 or 80.
But if you're going for absolute stability, then the plates and neutralisation plates, so it shouldn't really matter which screws you don't use.
Correct.
Can you explain to us why you don't use locking screws in the shaft?
Because of my Jewish Scottish heritage. So what you need to think about is why were locking screws invented? They were invented for short segment fixation. That's exactly what this is. Invented for getting fixed angle fixation in osteoporotic bone in the area above a joint. That's exactly what this is. Okay. But up in the shaft, there really hasn't been as much of a problem as many people think. If you've got this reduced, if you've got the fracture reduced, my personal experience is I haven't had a lot of failures in the shaft. That I can recall, and I think Tim's the same.
If you look at your failures and then look at the locking screws in the shaft, there's a definite correlation. Now maybe they're more complex fractures, but when these first came out 15 years ago, we kind of locked everything too stiff. We all learned our lesson. But you only got to go to trauma meetings around the country and you see people put quite a lot of lock screws in the shaft and you think that's too stiff. And I bet you that's a reason, but a common reason for failures.
Chris?
So I virtually never put locking screws in the diaphysis, and it was a lesson learned early on as an early user. And I think what you do is you change when they fail, because everything fails, none of us have things that don't fail, but you change your failure mode. And failure mode of non-locking screws is much easier to deal with as a revision trauma surgeon than it is than toggle in the screw. So I virtually never use diaphyseal locking screws now. I think that convergently around the world, a lot of experience have gone in the same direction. I don't think you need them.
I never thought you needed them.
Chris and I sat in meetings 10 years ago when these first started to come out, and we were looking at how the fracture heals. Let's imagine this is a B type or a C type. And you look at the pattern of callus that forms. When you use locking screws in the shaft, you get loads of callus here, right, on the compression side, and you get very little callus over here. So what did the companies come up with? They came up with the angular stable locking, dynamic locking
or
screw. Well, to my mind, dynamic locking screw, isn't that just a normal screw? Which costs a hundredth of the price. So just take a step back, try and make it something that has a little bit of movement in there to try and make your callus and your strain that the fracture heals symmetrical, and you will have less trouble.
Okay, I'm going to move on just for time. So, 86-year-old female.
I assume you fully weight.
Yeah, fully weight bear. Yeah, who would fully weight bear that patient? Yeah. Everyone now. That's different from 5 years ago. 86-year-old female. So this is a standard kind of osteoporotic. It's an intracontral split. I haven't got a CT, but she had a CT. I haven't got it. But it's basically a split just on the lateral femoral condyle and on the lateral femoral condyle. So who would randomise this into traffics? Everyone, no, any harm for them. So the ones not randomizing, who were treated with a nail?
The condylus there.
Yes.
There's a split down there. It's quite an old case. Who would treat this with a nail? Who treated the non-randomised? Who treated with a plate? Okay. So now fix, replace, position, reduction. So who if you treated a plate? Who would treat it laterally, and who should you supine? But that's a different question. So it's about reduction, isn't it? So who thinks they can then reduce that fairly quick, you know, percutaneously or with a small incision? Everyone think that's a fairly simple fracture pattern. So who's going to do a little lateral incision for their plate? Who's going to do a midline incision for that? Lateral incision? Midline? So there's something completely different. So I treat it with a nail, and I reduce it through just that percutaneous clamp which I put through the jaws and some wires. It's not perfect actually, I agree, but it's probably not off that articulate. I was the only person doing a nail, wasn't I?
I'd do a nail, but I would do something slightly different.
So what would you do?
And the reason I'd do something slightly different is, Tim, this is where you need to know your product. It might be worth going on to the next.
Okay. So I think the key here is getting intrafibrillary compression between the condyles, isn't it, for your nail to work. And I don't think you can just rely on those cross screws of the nail. And we use these bolts, which really squeeze it really tight, so that if you've got the variability of these. And it really squeeze out in the condyle fraction. And then if you use a purpose designed supercondylar nail, you can get a different plane of fixation with the oblique screws, which gives you good fixation. And for us, that's all we required in this.
So I don't have that product on the shelf, and as far as I'm aware, the company that makes that product, who are currently sponsoring it, so the only company that make those bolts that lock in from either side. So I've got a different product on my shelf. So if you just go back one, Tim. So for me, I would still nail this, but I can't do that percutaneously because I haven't got the bolt. So I would probably do a total knee type approach to be able to see it, to reduce it. Then use standard interfragmentary screws, part threaded cancellous screws, to get my compression, make sure they're anterior and posterior of where I'm going to put the nail in, and then put the nail in. And then use the nail in the same thing. Exactly the same rationale, same thing, but I haven't got a product that compresses through the
bolts. I think regardless of having the bolts or not, the ability to reduce a articular fracture to acceptable position in an 86-year-old can be achieved percutaneously. I don't think you need to
open. Okay, now that's an interesting concept because this, a lot of people feel that you have to have a proper lag effect to be able to squeeze it together, and that's not true. You need to think again about what the fracture feels in terms of the strain. So if you can clamp those bits of bone together with some sort of periarticular reduction clamp and then fix it in that position, and you can use a position screw for that, a fully threaded cortical screw for that, then take your reduction clamp off, the bone tries to spring back, but the screw is holding it there, and you have affected absolute stability.
Yeah, I agree, but I don't...
You don't have to do it openly.
You don't need to do that.
You don't need to
chase it at 86.
Yeah. I want to go to the last. So treat like that, full weight there. That's post-op, which was pretty split, just because stability-wise, yeah, pretty perfect pain, so yeah, in 6 months. She can take it. Maybe it doesn't look too bad. They won't make any difference. So I just want to go to the last case. This is an intraperitoneal fracture. We're going to see this in the cases from next year. So well-fixed hip replacement, well-fixed knee replacement, functioning extremely well, they've been in for a couple of years. She's not good protoplasm, mobile with a stick, COPD, previous severe weakness on the other side, clavix, you know, everything you expect of this age group. Traffics?
They're explicitly excluded.
Explicitly excluded. So everyone's going to plate this.
Well fixed hip.
So, everyone's going to plate this?
Yeah.
Who's just going to bridge plate it? Incision the top and bottom. Okay. Locking your top. Hands up for locking your top.
Okay. Four screws.
So locking screws only.
Four screws.
Anyone do anything different?
I don't think I need to happen. If you get screwed into the cement,
You think you screw through bicycle screw through cement is better than a lock screw?
Yeah. You're not going to get a lock screw at the top because it'll be right in the middle of the
You can't get. I don't think you get lock screws because you're placed in the right position.
You can get unicorticals, the periarticular lock screws, but you'll only get unicorticals.
Drill holes.
So you can get little side bars on different plate systems to get some lock screws in, but they tend to be unicortical, don't they?
They're transcortical.
Okay. So bridge plates. Should we talk about that?
Yes.
So anyone reduce that fracture? Anyone put any lag screws through that fracture?
I mean, it's pure anecdote, but one of my first cases of these when I got my consultant job was just like this, and I bridged it, and I thought I'd done a fantastic job, and it looked great, and then she disappeared and arrived back 3 months later having missed any follow-up appointment, and she had a 45-degree angle at the point where my plate, where the bridging portion was. So she'd stumbled in the shower apparently for 4 weeks and had bent her plate and came back at the 3 month mark.
And had you locked the top, locked the bottom?
Yeah, I'd locked the top and bottom in this situation. So, and when we kind of looked at it critically, well, the comment was, well, maybe I should have put some screws in the intervening fragments. Now, maybe I was unlucky. I mean, clearly it actually did go on to unite in this awful position. So I'm a little bit more circumspect, and I wonder if I should be getting more macroscopic, you know, more stability with some screws that purchase in that metaphyseal fragment, in that metaphyseal combination.
So I would go back to my concept principle of looking at the fracture pattern here. So
I've got some CTs actually.
So it's a type B. I think that's a B type with big pieces. And for me, B types with big pieces, I would put those big pieces together and then I'd have a big neutralisation plate. Does anyone do anything different? So who would completely bridge it? Forget the fragments? Okay, who would put the big pieces back together and neutralise it? And just very quick, there's a comment down here. Who would do it on traction? Who would do it free?
Who would do lateral? It's much easier, I promise you, especially in those top schools. So we've got 4 or 5 minutes left, so we're
going to. I think it's important to point about the lateral. I think it is easier for the proximal position, particularly when you're trying to fit around where there's cement in particular.
Especially when you've got them supine, even if up on a knee bolster, the plate weighs a bit, especially if it's got a jig on, it kind of always drops down. You always have to hold it up and wire it on or something. When you've got a lateral, it just kind of sits there. And it's so easy to just check it on screening with a quick image. So you can struggle. So my colleague did this a couple of weeks ago, and I talked to him about lateral. He had never done a lateral. He came out and said, that was so much easier. So he did this. So we did do a bit of a more of an open approach to reduce it. And he did put some black screws, so it's 28 to 12, that's 2 weeks ago. And he did this. So he had a couple of locking screws in a distal segment through the plate, and the rest was all non-locked, and three separate lag screws through the fracture to regain the fracture reduction. Now, this is evidence-free. Yep.
I was going to ask what people thought about whether bridging versus reduction technique made a difference to whether you mobilise the patient more or less aggressively.
So if you just bridge the hip, would you mobilise any different? Well, 89-year-olds to me, that question's always gone now, because you're just going to mobilise everyone,
so,
and take the chance.
So people who have been bridged, would they actually seriously mobilise the patient?
I think we've all realised that we can't protect our fixations by non-mobilising the patient.
I mean, some of us, I agree with that, we're pretty nervous.
Yeah, well, I think we are nervous, and we will have failures. But for the amount of failures we get compared to what we do to that patient.
No, I'm trying to make myself stronger, but I still have secret signs.
Spinach.
The other little tip we were going to give you here, Richard brought it up, is if you look proximally, those are standard screws.
Non-locked
standard screws that are fired around the prosthesis in the cement. and they are considerably easier to put in than your periarticular unicortical lock screws, and considerably easier, actually, and dare I say it, safer than trying to wire proximal. And the evidence, and I don't believe in the in vitro evidence for this, is they are as good as one.
I think when you try to do this, the posterior cortex of the femur up there is much stronger than the anterior cortex, which is really thin. So if you can try and get posteriorly and angle it posteriorly, you get a much better bite than anteriorly. But there is no evidence for this, but this is what we do. And I think putting those big fragments back together again makes me feel more confident it's going to, you know, the bone hasn't got a huge amount of callus to form with an 89-year-old on steroids.
But aren't you mixing principles there? You're using a bridging plate and you're using bridging.
It's a neutralisation plate.
It's a neutralisation
until the first screw gets loose.
Do you protection reduce with light screws around your nails when you fix that seal fractures as well? Isn't that the same principle?
It is. The nail's a stronger device than the lateral plate, so I don't have to worry about it so much. And the nail is more of a weight share loading device than the plate. So I wouldn't do that routine. So
the nice thing
in tibias, occasionally we do.
So the nice thing about traffics is that, if, correct me if I'm wrong, Xavier, we can do what we like with the nail. And for that very distal one that we had previously, which I would have nailed, if it was like a pork sausage in a Mersey tunnel, a broomstick in a big jar, then I'd put a blocking screw in the side to increase the rigidity of the construct around the nail for a type A fracture.
Traffics, you can do any type of fixation you wish, as long as you use a nail or a lock plate.
So if it was uncemented and the stem filled the whole canal, how would it be proximal fixation?
Go for the cortex.
It's unicortical.
Now you can get oblique screws, and often they can almost unicortical because it's kind of, but you get an oblique screw around it. It's very rare that you're going to get a prosthesis which is going to fill the whole canal through the whole
length of the plate. That's the problem.
And actually, with this case, because you just bring the plate out of neutralisation, you can whack in some screws below the wing.
So that was done, that was a small open incision at the bottom, and stab incisions at the top, which threw on the lateral position. So it's, again, easy to assess the reduction and judge the reduction and judge the functions. We're running out of time because we've got to finish in a couple of minutes. Any other questions? This is not right, this is not, this is just bringing up some discussion cases.
Moving away from plates back to nails, ASLS screws are convenient.
Sorry, say that again?
The ASLS screws.
Anglo-stable screws.
You haven't found an indication for them yet.
Okay,
they're pretty good. Well, fixed CTs, super distal tibias. Sorry? Super distal tibial fractures, nail. So you think they could be used for distal tibial fractures, fixed
angle screws and
nails?
Super distal tibias. Where you
but the reoperation rate of only
1%
is
too low to nail.
So some of them did have ASLS screws.
Yes.
Did they?
Sorry, would it?
And did any of those fixed ET have the angular stable screws?
Oh, it was a small number. I mean, they weren't really available at the beginning.
No, I was going to say.
But yeah, there were some used. Yeah. Interestingly, the blocking screws that Nigel talked about, which I thought. You know, that was kind of the vogue and what people were talking about to support the nail fixation to increase the stability. We're only using in a handful of cases.
Yeah.
So most people weren't using it.
So we got a non-union rate of 1% in distal tibial fractures, which we agree is the most difficult nail we're going to do. Do we need anything else to change that? I mean,
it's going to be difficult to show an improvement.
It would be. It would be a big study in that to prove it. I mean, I don't know the answer. So yeah. Is it company driven, or is it going to be a clinical benefit? Okay. I'm going to wrap it up. I'd like to thank Nigel for presenting. I'd like to thank, actually, this whole meeting is covered by sponsorship. I know you've paid a contribution to the meeting, but actually, we need the sponsors for the companies. And Strike actually sponsored this symposium. Each company sponsored, Gold sponsored one symposium each. So I'd like to thank Strike here in the back of the room for sponsoring us and sponsoring my mission. So thank you very much.